many people don't know this, but heating and cooling of buildings and transport refrigeration accounts for 25% of the world's CO2 emissions. It's very important that we start to look at how the energy is used in buildings. It's an industry which has been very traditional in the past, and it's ripe for innovation. Buildings could have the potential to become energy sources. There is no decarbonizing our future without decarbonizing buildings. Traditionally, you know, buildings weren't cooled. If we go back 200-300 years, cooling is quite a new thing, but heating has always been done in buildings, and heating has always been achieved through burning fossil fuels, initially burning wood, later burning coal, and eventually burning natural gas in gas boilers. Today, most buildings have a cooling plant and a heating plant, and those plants are not connected. And what is really absurd is that a lot of times, buildings require heating and cooling simultaneously. My name is Jose La Loggia, and as a mechanical engineer, I like to create things, I like to innovate. I studied engineering in Sydney, in Australia, and mechanical engineering. I graduated in 1994, and I basically joined Trane the week after. Trane Technologies is a heating and cooling company and a transport refrigeration company, and we consider ourselves as climate innovators. It's a sector which can really contribute to the reduction of CO2 emissions. We see a future where we have renewable energy production, heating and cooling of buildings, and some sort of energy storage, whether it be electrical storage or thermal storage, all acting in unison to create even more efficient buildings. A net zero building generates enough energy to run its own facilities without taking energy from the grid. They repurpose energy, so they recover energy, and they drive a lot of energy efficiency. If net zero buildings were the norm, we would have less pollution because there would be less energy being used, less fossil fuels being burnt. When we talk about heating and cooling of buildings, we need to understand that there is free heat all around us. We need to be able to move heat, and this is the concept of the heat pump. Combining heating and cooling can not only happen at the building level, but it can happen at the city level. A great project we worked on was with the city of Alzmir, where they had a data center, a school, and a gymnasium. So the data center was being cooled and rejecting heat, and the school and the gymnasium needed heat to heat their facilities. So what the city did, it incorporated a Trane heat recovery system to recover this heat and use that to heat the gymnasium and the school. And by doing so, they save 400 metric tons of CO2 emissions, the equivalent of 48 homes on a yearly basis. Some of the obstacles to creating net zero buildings are not technological, they're really cultural and traditions. And we need, as an industry, to change those traditions to start to look at the services in a building in a more combined way. For example, one obstacle that always comes up is cost, that these solutions are more expensive than traditional solutions. However, implementing these new technologies, because of the energy efficiency and the reduction in CO2 emissions, they have very short payback, sometimes within the 2 to 3 year period. Another perception is that these systems are very complex to implement and that they can only be applied in new construction. However, this is not true. 75% of our business is a replacement business. We replace chillers, meaning we replace machines that produce cold water. When you're replacing cooling-only machines with machines that make heating and cooling, the incremental cost is not so much more. Financing is sometimes seen as a barrier to achieving net zero buildings. However, financing is always there. We just need to finance the future, not the old systems. When all of these barriers are broken at the building level and at the city level, buildings will no longer be energy sinks, they will be energy sources. I believe we can get to net positive buildings, and the reason I give for that is that if we think about today in Europe, there are some countries producing more energy that is required. So the goal then is to connect that excess energy to buildings, and then buildings can become net positive. This breaking of silos, whether they're energy production, energy storage, heating, cooling silo, as we combine all those silos into one net zero building, there is an incredible amount of innovation that can happen and an incredible amount of creativity. So it will happen. It's just a question of time.